Again with CAT Geology and Geophysics paper. So as per my promise, today I am going to solve the numerical problem from GATE 2015 and 16. So hope you like it. Let's go. So the first question is, a drainage basin with an area of 2 into 10 to the power 6 meter square receives a continuous rainfall for 48 hours at a uniform rate of 3 millimeter per hour. The volume of PPT is, that is precipitation of rain, is dash meter cube of water. So it is from GATE 2015 paper. So here we have to find the total volume of precipitation of water. So if we see the question, a lot of things are given, right? The area of drainage basin, that is 2 into 10 to the power 6 meter square, it is given. Then the rate of rainfall is 3 millimeter per hour. That means 3 into 10 to the power minus 3 meter per hour. If we convert this millimeter into the meter, it becomes 3 into 10 to the power minus 3 meter per hour. The rainfall lasts for 48 hours. Okay. Yani for 2 days. Thus, the water column made by the rainfall for 48 hours. So we multiply this rate, that is 3 into 10 to the power minus 3 meter per hour, with total time. So it's not meter, sorry, this is 48 hours. So when we multiply this both the things, it becomes 144 into 10 to the power minus 3 meter cube. Okay, so this is the multiplication of the rate as well as the time. So the now we have the total water is around 144 into 10 to the power minus 3 meter cube. Hence the volume of precipitation is the total area, that is 2 into 10 to the power minus 6 meter square into the whole volume. So when we multiply this 2, we get the total volume of precipitation in meter cube of water. So the final answer is 288,000 meter cube of water. So it is very easy. All you have to know is how to proceed. So moving to the next question. So this question is from geophysics. So here we know that there are different types of array in resistivity survey. Here it is Minner array, then we have Schlumberger array. Another one is called pole dipole array, and another one is pole pole array. So in the case of Winner array, the current electrodes and the potential electrodes are fixed at a same distance. So you can see that these two are P1, P2 are the what to say, this P1, P2 are the potential arrays, while the C1, C2 are current arrays. So here we can see that the distance between the potential array as well as the potential array and the the distance between the potential electrodes and the potential and current electrodes are same, that is A. So let's check out the question. A Wiener array with a 60 meter spacing, that means the space between these two currents, current electrode is 60 meter. Spacing 60 meter between the current electrodes is placed in an homogeneous ground. So the ground is inhomogeneous. If the measured potential difference and the current flow in a subsurface are 10 millivolt and 5 milliampere respectively. So here the potential difference is 10 millivolt and the current flow is 5 milliampere. The apparent resistivity will be in ohm meter. So we have to find finally the apparent resistivity. So for this question, all you have to know is the formula, this formula, that is the apparent resistivity rho a is equal to 2 pi a into change in the that is potential difference by current difference, current flow difference. So the given one is C1, distance between C1 and C2 is 60 meter. So we divide this 60 by 3 because the electrode difference are same. So it becomes A is equal to 20 meters. So each A becomes 20, 20, 20. Now the potential difference given is 10 millivolt, and the current difference is, current flow difference is 5 milliampere. Thus the apparent resistivity obtained by the Wiener array is rho A is equal to 2 pi A into delta B by delta I. So when we solve this question, the answer becomes 251.2 ohm meter. So this is a question from GATE 2016. So here we can see that it's not a very tough question. It's like, if you know the formula, you come to know the answer, that's it. So remember, this two are very important, this Wiener array and Schlumberger array, they always ask this type of question in geophysics. This is not from geology paper, this is from geophysics paper. So moving to the next question, water content and the total porosity of the soil are given 10% and 25%, means water content is 10 and total porosity is 25% respectively. Specific gravity of the soil particle is 2.5 gram per centimeter cube, and the volume of water that should be added to 100 meter cube of the soil for the full saturation we have to find. So basically we have to find how much volume of the water is required to saturate a soil of 100 meter cube. So here we can see that total soil is 100 meter cube, right? Here 100 meter cube. Pore species, here it is given that the porosity is 25%, means 25% is 25 meter cube is the pore space and remaining soil is 75%. So let us consider the soil, and the given density of the soil is 2.5 gram per centimeter cube. So it is already given the specific gravity and all. So it is given total soil is 100 meter cube considered. So we know that the mass of the particle in 75 meter cube of the volume is this much. How? We know that mass is equal to density into volume. Volume is given, that is 75, and when we multiply with 2.5, it becomes 187.5, and then we convert into the kg. So we multiply with 10 to the power 3. Now the water content is 10%. So initially the water content is 10%, right? So the mass, when the water content is 10%, then what we do is we multiply with this 10%, that is 10 by 100, that becomes 0.1. So it finally becomes 18.75 into 10 to the power 3 kg. But we know that water density of the water is 1000 kg per meter cube. So the volume of the water becomes this much mass by this 1000 kg per meter cube. So we know that the volume is equal to mass by density. In the same way, here it is mass and this is density. So the final volume becomes 18.75. Now we have to calculate how much volume of water should be added to 100 meter cube of the soil for full saturation. So what we do is, then for full saturation, volume of water to be added is 100 minus 75, because this is the 75%. We have to saturate this thing. So we subtract 75 and then we add this 18.75 to get the final answer. So the answer becomes 6.25 meter cube. So it's a easy, it's an easy concept. So moving to the next question, if the tangent's Young's modulus at 50% of uniaxial compressive strength and the modulus ratio of a rock are given by 60 GPa and 500 respectively, the uniaxial compressive strength of the rock is dash megapascal. In megapascal, we have to find. So the tangent Young's modulus, given that it's a 60 GPa, right? So we convert this 60 GPa into MPa. So we multiply this with 1000, then it becomes 60,000 MPa. and modulus ratio already given, it is 500. So the formula of uniaxial compressive strength is tangent Young's modulus by modulus ratio. Then we divide this 6000 MPa by 500, it becomes 120 MPa. So here we see that if you know this, the formula, this that much formula, you solve this question, it's very easy. So remember, uniaxial compressive strength is the ratio of tangent Young's modulus and modulus ratio. So this is from GATE 2016. So moving to the next question. Okay. Now we have this oxygen O18 and O16. So remember, these two isotopes are non-radiogenic isotopes of oxygen. Oxygen 18 is the heavier one, 16 is the lighter one. And both are used as a proxy for paleo temperature. So if we have more like oxygen 18 to the 16 ratio is more in the water, that means melting happen. And if it is less, that means freezing happen. So we can relate this thing with glaciation and interglaciation thing. Now coming to the question, the ratio of oxygen 18 to the 16 of a quartz sample is a value of 0.0019, and the volume of delta O18 of a quartz sample dash. So we have to find this delta O18 of a quartz sample. We have the ratio of these two, 18-16, and from this ratio we have to find the value of delta O18 in the quartz sample. We can use this ratio of VSMOW as it is given, 0.002005. So given, coming to the answer, given is oxygen O18 to the 16 in sample, that is 0.0019, and we have to find this thing, delta O18, and this is given, standard value is given already. So the standard value, it is here, 0.002005. So the formula for this is delta O18 is equal to ratio of oxygen 18-16 in the sample by ratio of oxygen 18-16 standard minus 1 into 10 to the power 3%. So I put all the values and the answer becomes minus 0.0524 into 10 to the power minus 3%. So this is the value of delta O18 into the inner quad sample. So point to be remembered is this thing, only the formula, that's it. So sample by standard minus 1 into 10 to the power 3%, that's it. So this is a question from GATE 2016. It's a very easy question. So I want to say that the questions of GATE is not like as hard as any other competitions, like if you go in core physics and all. It's a little bit tricky, and only thing is you need to know the formulas behind the questions, that's it. So moving to the next question, considering the Aries isostatic compensation for a mountain having an elevation of 2 km above the mean sea level, at a point P, the thickness of its roots below the P would be dash kilometer. So using this Aries isostatic compensation method, we have to find the root of a mountain below some point P. Okay. Now the given thing is crustal density and upper mantle density, that is 2.7 gram per centimeter cube and 3.3 gram per centimeter cube respectively. So from the Aries model, we know that the root depth of the mountain is equal to root of the mountain, or root depth of the mountain is equal to crustal density by upper mantle density minus crustal density into h. H is the elevation of mountain. So here we can see that the whole formula, Pc is the crustal density, This is the upper mantle density minus crustal density into H. So we all have the values. We have the values 2.7 by 3.7 minus 2.7 into 2 kilometers. So when we solve this, the answer becomes 9 kilometers. That means at some point P, the depth of or you can say the root depth of the mountain is 9 kilometers. So it is from gate 2015. It's very easy questions. So remember this Aries model of and its formula. That's it. Moving to the next question. Okay, now it is from geophysics. The reflection coefficient at an interface separating sandstone having P wave velocity 2000 meter per second and density 1.5 gram per centimeter cube underlain by a shale deposit having a P wave velocity 2500 meter per second and density 2.0 gram per centimeter cube is. So we have to find this reflection coefficient at the interface between sandstone and a shale. So given things are P wave velocity in sandstone and P wave velocity in shale with their density respectively. So here the concept is always subtract the higher values from the lower values. Thus the reflection coefficient at the interface of SST, that is sandstone, and the shale is R equal to Vp into rho for shale. Why it is for shale? Because it has higher value here, minus Vp into rho of sandstone by Vp into rho of shale plus Vp into rho of SST, that is sandstone. So remember, always start with the higher values. So firstly we subtract these two values in numerator and then in denominator we add these two values. So when we solve this entire problem, we get the answer of 0.25. So this is the coefficient, reflection coefficient at the interface separating sandstone and the shale. So it is from GATE 2015 paper. Moving to the next question. So it's a not fully numerical type of question, but it's a bit of theory and numerical. So question is, Gardiner's formula relate the seismic P wave velocity with. So basically this formula gives the relation of how the P wave velocity varies with the different parameters like bulk density and some constants. Now coming to the answer is density. Why density? So this Gardiner's formula is basically an empirical equation that relates P wave velocity with bulk density. Now this rho is signifies the density equal to density is equal to alpha P wave velocity, that's why we have Vp, and beta is the constant. So here we can see that this rho is the bulk density in gram per centimeter cube, Vp is the P wave velocity, and alpha beta is the empirical derived constant depends upon the geology of that area. So here we can see that this density is directly proportional to this Vp. So the right answer is density. Now moving to the next question. This is from GATE 2015. Now moving to the next question. A drainage basin with an area of, we already solved this question. Yeah. So that's it for the today. So hope you like it. Please do like, subscribe and comment to my channel. And we will solve the another questions from CSIR, NetGRF as well as GATE. Okay, in coming video. So thank you very much.